So, hi, my name is Patrick, and for those people who have been following me, like on Twitter, not just so, probably realize that I'm really into type systems, like all this kind of, yeah, exactly, and especially into the type system called flow type. And I mean, first of all, this is going to be a talk about flow runtime. But before I dive into this topic, I need to set the stage, kind of. And just to take it away from the beginning, flow type, for those people who are not familiar with that, is a tool to add static types to your JavaScript in a non-intrusive way. And I'm not going to discuss with you how the syntax works. I'm not going to discuss what kind of features it supports, and I'm not going to do a comparison with any other type system. So to get this out of the way, just to get a small idea of who is familiar with type system, just raise your hands if you have been using TypeScript or FlowType or ReasonML. All right, awesome, that's really great. So I don't have to discuss all this stuff. If it's confusing for you, if I show some examples and you are not understanding what's happening right now, just shut out and I will explain it very shortly. Okay, and what I'm going to try to do is, I have a lot of problems with using a type system. I mean, it's great, but it has its downsides at some point, and I want to discuss one topic, which is static versus runtime types. And just to start the discussion, I will start with runtime types. So, runtime types are great, kind of. These are like the major selling point of dynamically typed languages like JavaScript. So what you have is you have like an interpreter of your code, which is the engine, V8. Looks nice. This is not an incident. This is a mouse trip here. V8 is very fast. It's very, very cool. And it can run any code what we throw at it. And we have this nice thing, which is called JavaScript. And JavaScript is like this nice kind slice of cheese. This is very funny because I'm working for a Swiss company right now, so we eat a lot of cheese, so I get inspired by that. So JavaScript is, I mean, you know mousetraps, so you can sneak in and you can get the cheese if you want to, but you have to be very, very careful. If you're not very careful, you snap your finger, which is not very good if you're a programmer and you need to type. And that you do this with one hand, right? So just remember you do this. And on the other hand, like with the other hand, you're playing a game of Jenga. Why Jenga? First of all, it's a very fun game. It's very fun to work with it and to play it. And second of it, you can imagine a Jenga tower like a program, right? So you take out a slice and you need to refactor stuff and you put it on top and it's getting brittler and more brittle. And at the same time, you're trying to like to handle the cheese. On the other hand, you're like trying to pull out the Jenga pieces, and you have no idea what's happening. And you need to, and probably you also need to like make sure the whole thing doesn't blow up. So like with your feet, and you're like really multitasking here. It's a lot of mental effort, as Ali said today. We need to handle a lot of mental effort, and this is just a language, and this is why I don't really like runtime types. So now I'm going to the other contrast, the static types. And static types, they are kind of very, static. So they are like frozen at some point. It's also very fun because if it melts, it's like flowing. So flow, just to get all the puns out. And I think they're really cool. So deal with it. They're here to stay at some point. I don't know. I think they are very important. And I want to explain why. So if you have static types, so I try to sell you flow now. if you add type annotations to your code, you can tell the type system what you expect. Like if you annotate a function, you can tell the flow, the type system, I want to have a string in this parameter in this function. So we have functions. And a function expects a type, T1, which can be anything. We call that a generic. And it returns a second type, T2, which can also be T1. So if you have a transformer function and stuff like this. And it's very, the scope is very easily set. So you have one pure function which doesn't do any side effects, for instance. We are talking about pure functional components in React. So we throw properties in, prop types, whatever, and we get a result, which is JSX, for instance. Very clear, very easy to test, and the mental effort to understand the function is very, yeah, bounded. If we take this to the next level, we have a module, which consists of several functions. If you think about it, you have a util folder with a lot of like very easy to understand functions. And flow kind of forces you into the way of modularizing the things and to try to scope things in one certain way. And if you're trying, think about the Jenga piece. If you try to pull out one thing, like you're putting a class somewhere else in another file or whatsoever, the type system will help you finding bugs. It will tell you, you import the file from another location, I don't find this, or you remove the property, which I cannot access here, it's undefined, so you should refactor that and type check. And this makes it very easy, also for third-party modules, if you have library definitions. This is a talk on its own, I also have talked about that in the past. But anyways, static types are really, really, really good in understanding the flow of the code, like where the data comes from, where the data goes to, and how the data transforms. Where it's not good at. So we have our function, which returns a type, for instance, a user type. And we have this thing, it's very annoying, I know, we have a REST endpoint, or we have user input, which is through a text box or whatsoever. This is something we cannot control. Like this, what we saw before, is in our control. We are working with the code, we are calling a function and whatnot, and Flow understands, okay, the code flows there, and I am aware of everything. And with that, we have a huge problem. Because if you're querying a REST endpoint, you get JSON data. So you get a bag, an object bag with a set of properties, and there is data in it. You have like practically seen, you have no idea what's in there. Of course, you have documentation from a backend team telling you, yeah, this looks like this. But like in reality, we had cases where we had like microservices, of course, and the microservices were collecting the data together. And sometimes there was a fault with one service. So the user property wasn't set. It was just null because the endpoint, like the collective endpoint, needs to return the data. So how do you find this? How do you know that this is T2? Flow cannot tell you, hey, your endpoint is going to send you wrong data here. So this is bad. So what we usually do, if you're a typer, you're relying on typecasts. Very similar to how you typecast in C, where you're sure, OK, this has to be a number. I'm so sure it has to be a number. But this is the element where we do a lot of mistakes, and then the whole thing blows up. I don't want that. Or at least, I would like to be warned if I do something wrong. And this is where runtime types excel, because you can have, if you think about React, we have prop types. You can define how the structure of a React component is defined, like the props. And it will warn you in the console while you're developing that you're passing down data which is not existing or which is malformed. So you're at least aware, okay, yeah, of course our staging server is sending us the wrong data because it's the older version of the backend. Stuff like this. And the thing is, what we can do to make sure that this is T2 is we put something in front of that, in front of the REST input, and validate it. So what we have is some kind of validation framework, or I don't know, for instance, a JSON schema, which can define the structure of the object and will raise an error if the data is malformed. So you can understand this might be an impact on performance and probably not what we want. But in general, if you want to guarantee that the program is working, you need to make sure that this is being validated to return T2 and not typecast at all. Yeah, so we have no idea what that is. So I call this, like I want to coin a term for that, and I say it's welcome to fake news county, where everything you think or believe in your bubble is actually not what happens during runtime. So yeah, so the obligatory Trump joke is there as well. Cool. Another thing where flow type is very bad at, we have a type string. For instance, we have a property in our user, which is an email. How can we ensure that we pass down an email into this property? We can't, because this is not how the type system works. Otherwise, it needs to be a runtime type system, but it's not. So we need a possibility to make sure to do some kind of validation process during runtime. And this, again, will require us to use a validation framework and write a schema, which is basically a carbon copy of your flow type definitions. So you have to maintain two definitions. One is truer than the other. It's super annoying. Nobody wants to do that. Introducing, now we're getting to the point, flow runtime. This is a framework or a set of tools which has been released like 1 or 2 months ago, or even several weeks ago. So it's, I guess it's not very new, it's very new. And it was made by, how do you call it, CodeMix. It's like a web agency somewhere in London. And they have, yeah, I was browsing on their blog, and they have been working a lot with Babel plugins, and they blogged a lot about it. Super interesting stuff. You should check it out if you have time. We all have time for that, yeah. So it's, what it does is it's a runtime type checker. And it happens, that's why it's called flow runtime, it happens to replicate what flow does during our, like, you know, while we're typing stuff. Huh, this came out wrong. So when we're like editing code, flow tells us during writing our code if we do something wrong. This thing is doing the opposite. It tells us during runtime if we do something wrong or if data passes in which is not well formed. So it's kind of React prop types on flow. And they deliver, it seems a little bit intimidating, but it's quite easy to understand what they try to achieve. So they have several packages here. Flow runtime, which is like the core thing with all the functionality in there. Then they have, and this is very essential, this Babel plugin flow runtime. And what it does is they get your code, they see, you have a type definition type user, and it brings the type into the JavaScript world. So if you imagine types code, if you say type user, JavaScript or Babel will strip it out, and you only have JavaScript. There is no way you can communicate with flow types. You cannot interact with flow types during runtime. And this thing, what it does is like necromancer magic stuff, voodoo magic. It takes the definitions like, come here, I make a runtime type out of you. And it's really ingenious. I really like the way they do it. It seems a little bit hacky, but I will show you. Okay, demo time. And this is also very nice. This is actually why they got my attention, because there are several runtime systems out there, but they do their marketing really well. So I guess because they're a web agency, they have a lot of good designers to make this well formed. So what you have is, I hope you can see that, a try area where you can just play around with it. And what we are going to do is, we're just showing off the functionality here. So we are using, don't worry if it's getting a little bit messy here with all this stuff. On the right side, you can see what Babel would transform. There are several options. You can say you just want to have assertions, or you just want to have warnings. An assertion would crash the application if you do something wrong, so it throws an error. And then warning is just your typical React prop types way of doing things. You get these yellow messages in your console that something is wrong here. And yeah. Anyways, let's say we have a user. And this user has an email, which is a string. To make it simpler, I would just do the email. I mean, it doesn't make any sense, but anyways, let's assume we have somewhere in our code a function which does a side effect. It queries the server. And I'm not doing like return a promise or something. This makes it more complicated than it really should be. And we will just return an email. And if we call it and run it, nothing happens. That's intentional. If nothing happens, this is good, because we didn't do anything wrong. If we try to do something wrong here, so let's say, actually just disable annotations, you see, if I do this, it will enhance the functions with the type checking mechanism. So if you have annotations here, it will automatically type check everything, all the data which is coming through. So we run this, and now we get an error. Type email must be a string. Of course it should. So if you're like having some developers in your team who are not doing the static type checking, because flow would have caught this error right away. But during runtime, if something happens, this thing would warn you. And another thing, by default, the Babel plugin only transforms this kind of stuff, like because this has a runtime impact, only in development mode. So if you're building for production, like for web, like in Webpack or something, it will not do anything. It will just, like, it doesn't exist, and it's really neat. Okay, so this is one thing. So we now got a little bit of runtime evaluation of our types. And sometimes you don't want to have this, you know, for development mode. You want to abuse this for validation. Like you have a form and you have a username or email, you just want to abuse that. This is also possible, but for that we need to do this necromancer kind of stuff. And we've got this thing here, reified. Sounds a little bit weird, but what we can do is we can get like this thing from the type world, like from the underground, in our real world by reifying it. And type user, this is generic, like really generic stuff. And now we can actually use that for validation. So we can say user type.assert run it. Must be a string. All right. So now we can use this. Now we can actually just use the types we defined and use it during runtime. There's also a lot of, they have some nifty configuration options there. You can also say, because I said they would only strip the whole thing out in production mode, we can actually explicitly say, okay, this file still needs to add this prop type validation or whatever you want there. So you can explicitly exclude that from stripping the types. Another thing, I talked about constraints, right? So what Flow Runtime has is another package, which is validators. So they have some common validators, what you usually expect, non-empty, non-null, and also email. That's very handy. So we use that here. So what we do is we can do a reflection on this now. We can get our email and add in constraint, which is email. And if you try to do this, it should theoretically throw an error. Yes. Type email must be a valid email address. And if we just go ahead, oh, no. Do that. Yes, now we got it. So this is a very simple example. I recommend to check it out, because you need to play around with it and get a feeling what's possible and what not. It's not perfect. I already tackled some edge cases, which are not good for me, but I'm pretty sure if a lot of people are bringing in the feedback, because not a lot of people assumingly will use this framework, we report this and it will be fixed. This guy is really motivated to make this really round and like complete. Yeah, so that was that. And another thing, because I told you there are a lot of things out there and a lot of other like runtime type checkers. And there's this one dude. I don't know, I astonish him, he's great. Giulio Canti, I don't know if I pronounced the Italian name right, but he's really into this static type system stuff as well, and also into type theory and category theory, so he's a mathematician. And I really recommend, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, just check out his Medium. And yeah, he has like a lot of flow type articles, and now he's also getting on the TypeScript bandwagon. It's really great. So another thing, he's also the author of TCOM, if you know that, and now the more lightweight version, Flow.io. And another, I just mentioned because I find it very cute, is EndryPop's Validated, which is also very, very easy to understand. It's very schema-like, and it integrates well with FlowType if you don't want to have this whole flow runtime baggage, whatever. And most importantly, I think they do it like perfectly. It's amazing. If you have seen David Nolan's talk here at React Vienna, like the crossover with the other meetup groups, he was talking about closure spec. And this is very similar to, like, it's doing the same things as Flow Runtime tries to do, but they have been doing this for, I don't know, 1 year now or even longer. So they are always pioneering all the new stuff that we just discover. So don't be blindfolded. Just check out other technologies as well, because you can learn a lot of that. Okay, so one more thing. Just since the React Vienna meetup group is like trying to push forward and be like the on the front of all web technology, we try to convince people a little bit more and like to promote a little bit more static type systems. And for the end of March or like in the beginning of April, I targeted to do a workshop about flow type. So if you're a complete beginner or if you're intermediate, I think it's very worthy to check it out. And this is going to be sponsored by React Vienna. So attendance is for free. The only thing you need to do is just leave an email with your name and your contact details. And we will let you know when we know an exact date and an exact curriculum. It's going to be 1 to maximum 2 days. And another announcement, sorry, relentless self-promotion here. There's going to be a ReasonML meetup. So this is going to be great, hopefully, on the 22nd of February in Zollergasse, which is on the opposite of Café Mick, if you know that. ReasonML is a great language. It's kind of a combination of JavaScript and flow type mixed together in a functional language with static typing. It's awesome. I love it. It's a little bit, in baby shoes, and it's getting really great.
Maybe to add, Jordan Walk, the original creator of React, he works on that full-time right now because he believes that's the future.
Exactly. So the React guy is working on that, like, eagerly. I believe. Okay. So just to throw in a Viennese proverb, the more generic, the harder to type. And this is super generic to say it anyways. So thank you very much. I'm up for questions.
So, yeah, we still have time, I guess. Let's check out.
It was only 23 minutes.
Woo. Yeah, very fast. We have time for questions. So if you have any questions, please ask Patrick. And also, Patrick, are you in Slack right now? Because I send you a link, you have to present on your computer because I don't want to, you know.
Let's do Q&A first.
Yeah, let's do Q&A and then the last announcement.
It's just about some items faster for the post. Drinks.
I just forget to record the screen. Oh no.
Never mind.
Just do it again.
I do it again. It's 23 minutes, right?
Okay, Q&A first. Yeah, this is the map, just so you can memorize it, because we will burn it right now.
Okay, so So after we get out here, we would like to gather for a drink, and we are really happy the more we are. It's always great. So we are going to some Altenfassel. And yeah. Okay, so the questions. I forgot the questions.
Well, I'm not sure I'm very familiar with Flow, so I don't know if this question is really appropriate. I don't know if Flow supports generics.
Yes, it does. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So does the Flow runtime also support like this generics?
It does support generics. I'm not sure how far it supports it. So if you check out the examples, they even support React prop types. So you have like thousands of examples. Yeah, you will probably find some things. They also have some very nice things like pattern matching functions and stuff like this, which you usually have in functional languages. So yeah, in some way they are really advanced. I was really surprised when it came out because it hit me like a truck. Suddenly some guy comes here and makes a whole ecosystem with plugins and whatnot. Yeah. All right, cool. So thank you very much.
One more question.
Oh, wait. Okay.
Is it possible to use the flow runtime only to annotate the rest endpoints?
Yes.
With the implementation and use the implementation?
Yes. So what I would recommend is, as you saw, you can reify this stuff. So reify just tells the Bubble plugin to get the type. And you just do that in the code you really want to validate code. So yeah, so you just do that, and then you, in your code, you use that assert function or warn function, whatever you want. That's it. And then you can catch the error and do something with it. You can also write your own validators with your own messages, and you can add your localization in there. So it's very, really round. I really like the API and stuff.
Okay, how much, like, what's the catch? How much bigger the bundle will be if you use it in this runtime thing?
This is the thing. That's something I don't know, because I just discovered it and I was like, oh, cool. Now you have a new topic for a talk, so you force yourself to learn it. I will probably investigate. I know that tcomp is very lean, like tcomp, the other framework I mentioned. And I mean, it doesn't matter. It depends. If you want to have the assurance, if there is a system which needs to be reliable, where you need to make sure that the data is in the right form, you need to include it. You need to include some framework.
Yeah. So, like, last time I used it, even before it became a flow runtime, it was just a Bubble plugin. I used it on one production project. So what I did is I used it in development mode and I stripped it out in production. So it didn't like increase the bundle size, but I still could catch, being in development mode as I was developing, I could catch lots of errors. So it's one of the options, but for stuff like custom assertions, I guess it should be in production. So that's why I asked.
Could that eventually replace the React prop types?
It can. It has support for React prop types.
It can. You can replace it right now.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. You can use Flow anyways for prop types,
sure.
And there is another plugin to handle that. But this framework concretely does it. Yeah.
But like prop types are like, that's the end of the life cycle. They don't invest in it, and they made it absolutely clear that prop types are going to be replaced by something, mm-hmm. And
it's Flow.
Could be Flow runtime, huh?
No, I mean, at some point you need to insert validation code.
Yeah.
So yeah, Flow is going to just abstract away this React prop type thing, and you just don't think about React prop types anymore.
Yeah.
This is also doing that.
Cool.
Thank you very much.